Hello and welcome. I'm Kamla. Nicholas Jarecki has a new film out called Arbitrage that stars Richard Gere, Susan Sarandon, Tim Roth, and others. This is his first debut feature film. He has previously made documentary films, one of them being Outsiders. We met with him in San Francisco, and here is an interview with Nicholas Jarecki.
A dedicated businessman, family man, a man I am very lucky to call my mentor and my father.
World events all revolve around five things. M-O-N-E-Y.
Why sell our company? We make a great return.
How much money do we need? Do you want to be the richest guy in the cemetery?
You don't ask.
The car rolled in multiple impacts. She was here, and her feet were down here.
So who kicked out the door?
The situation would be manslaughter. What would you advise such a person to do?
There's about 50 things that person wouldn't have thought of.
Fingerprints, DNA, cell phone records.
That person were closing a merger with a large bank. Any arrest could derail the transaction.
Half of the fund's assets are missing. There's a $400 million hole here.
That's ridiculous. You're looking at 1,000 years jail time.
What am I supposed to do?
Yeah.
There's a Detective Breyer here to see you.
We haven't located the driver.
The driver?
Yeah, someone else was driving. What happened to your head?
I hit it on a medicine cap.
Hate when that happens.
Detective Breyer, is this about your husband?
Fine, make an appointment.
He's my dad. I have to trust him.
This is a homicide.
I know he went to pick him up.
The more time that passes, the more lies are told.
Did you want me to let our investors go bankrupt?
You lied.
We were going broke.
The police have been trying to talk to me, and I'm not going to lie for you.
The guy did it. He does not get to walk just because he's on CNBC.
I am your partner.
You are not my partner. You work for me.
You brought this to our door.
Everything I do is for us, for this family. Now you're telling me how to run my business?
This isn't about your business, this is our life.
Welcome to the show.
Thank you, pleasure to be here.
Your first feature film, you've been doing, in some sense, a PhD thesis, because at 19 you graduated from NYU, and then you wrote that book about how directors make it big.
Breaking 20 film directors get their start.
And then you did Outsider.
Yeah, a documentary about an independent film being made.
And Toback is famous for Bugsy, in case we don't recognize his name.
And went on to direct Tyson, which I produced for him.
Yes. So this film is very interesting because it's essentially a film about a subject that you're intimate with.
Well, we were just talking before we rolled film here, and both my parents are commodities traders, so my earliest memories at 5 years old visiting my mother at the World Trade Center and having her try to explain to me what a swap was in her office. Then I'd walk across the courtyard to my dad's office, and he was, "Hey, your mother doesn't understand anything, it's all wrong, and here's what it is." And so this lovely, background dinner conversation. And then later in life, I got interested in business myself, and had some of my own computer businesses in the first internet bubble. So I knew all about the world of business on a personal level. It was a fascinating experience growing up, knowing about that, and then seeing the third bubble of my life explode, which is when I decided to write this film.
Which is the housing crisis bubble.
Yeah, I've been through three now, 87, we got pretty wiped out,
that was the Black Friday, right?
Yeah, the Black Friday, and then the tech bubble in 2000, and now houses. I don't know what's next, air.
When did you first hear of the word arbitrage, the term?
Well, it was always a concept that interested me because my first love was computer hacking, and so that's how I got into films. Actually, I served as a technical advisor on Hackers with Angelina Jolie. And so my job was to teach the actors and the director about computer hacking. And so there's the hacker spirit is very much about finding, you know, a different approach to a problem, a scheme, a way in that nobody expected or predicted. And so a business arbitrage is kind of like that in a way. I got something over here I can buy real cheap, and I got people over here willing to pay this price, and only I know that, so boom, I can lock that in and make myself some money in the process. And that appealed to me. I guess I did a domain name arbitrage early in my career, maybe when I was 15. I registered some different internet domain names, and along came some companies that wanted to buy them from me. So these things that I had put down for $15, I was able to sell for $5,000 or $10,000.
So were you a squatter?
There might have been a little squatting going on. When I did it, it wasn't really squatting. You know, there weren't rules on this subject. But what one of the nice things that I did is I got some different companies to donate money to charity. And so that made it more satisfying. But it's interesting when you're 15 years old and companies have, you know, private investigator calling, threatening you. You learn very, you know, I think if I were you, I'd turn this thing over. You know, I don't know what's going to happen if you don't. I really think it's in your best interest, Mr. Jarecki. And so, you know, we got my lawyer in there and then we kind of sorted it out. But so sitting across the table at 15 from like power players at, you know, Debevoise and Plimpton, big law firms. It's a trial by fire. I mean, business is just a big game. So.
It's a big game, but then when you talk about arbitrage, I was wondering if you'd mention your dad's name, because he was part of Mercato, one of the oldest bullion trading company in the world. He's a professor by trade.
He's first a psychiatrist and then a teacher at Yale. And, you know, both of my parents, they weren't like black box people where they did, you know, computerized trading arbitrage or stuff like that. It was more of an abstract concept. But what my dad did early in his career is, you know, he worked a lot in the metals markets. He took over the helm of that company, Mercata. And there was, there's, you know, definitely movies to be made about this, but what he did with the silver markets, and people were trying to corner the silver market. Yeah, and, you know, they were trying to do their own arbitrage, and he went against them. And I remember my mother having a similar situation with coffee and sugar. You know, people, speculators, they try to run up the market. They try to play all kinds of games. Any game you can think of, somebody's trying to play it. But the great thing is there's always someone on the other side trying to play it.
And I started off by saying your own backyard, because the film is a distilled essence of what you have witnessed and been part of growing up in your family, because your family was in the business.
I mean, I grew up in New York, so I was exposed to tons of people. Some people struggling to get by as the film documents, and some very wealthy people living at the top of the world. And so I was keeping notes and, you know, thinking. I mean, it's material that fascinates me. It's kind of Shakespearean in its scope. You know, it's we call the big hedge fund traders the masters of the universe, you know, and I like that idea that the living outside the margins of society, just as Jimmy Grant, who represents a poor character in this film, you know, he's living outside the margins of his own society. So I like those extreme characters.
So the thing that rescues the film in some ways is Gere does something bad, but he does it for the family at the end. So is that your escape clause for making him kind of a good guy?
Well, you know, I wasn't really trying to manipulate you into a particular opinion of him. I was more trying to present what I felt was true.
Right, but he's a family guy, so the family aspect plays a key role in the storytelling.
Certainly. I mean, he is, I think, as many great leaders are, you know, he's a plate juggler. He has many things going on in his life. So it's quite possible that he can love his family and care very deeply at them, and at the same time love himself and put his needs ahead of everybody else. You know, I kind of thought that he's the emotional arbitrageur, Robert Miller. He buys his people that love him very cheap, and he gets a lot of value from them. So I think there's an exploitational component in his behavior that's fascinating to watch. But where what you say, you know, does it rescue him? I think I like those films. I'm a great fan of films from the 1970s, you know, with anti-heroes, Michael Corleone, and, you know, Dog Day Afternoon. You can follow Prince of the City. You can follow these characters that you don't necessarily agree with their behavior, but you understand it. And, you know, you have the privilege to say, thank God I'm not in that situation.
Why did you wait so long to make your first feature film?
Why did I wait? You say it as if it was a choice.
Yes, it was a choice because you made documentaries and...
Well, I've been trying to make a feature film for a long time. It's incredibly difficult. It's really a very closed system. You know, I wrote that book about film directors and how they got started, and the answer is by any means necessary, because the store is closed. They don't want any new people. It's a very small club of people making films. And for a new person to come in, pretty much one of the existing people has to die or fail. And so...
You sound like Toback now.
Well, I mean, it's just the true reality. So it's real hard to get in, and because films are expensive to do, and this is a low-budget film, you know.
It doesn't look like low-budget.
I know it doesn't, and I'm very proud of what we accomplished. I had a brilliant cinematographer, you know, but we made this film for, you know, in the $10 to $15 million range. Compared to a regular $40, $50 to $100 million movie, that's not a lot of money. However, it is a lot of money. So I had to go convince people to give me millions of dollars, and convince these great actors that this was worth taking a chance. I go, oh, well, great, well, what else have you done? Well, let me check out your other movie. I didn't direct a fiction movie yet. You never done anything and you want me to do this? What, are you nuts? All right, well, maybe you are, but I like the script, so let's do it. So I think it took a while before I was able to write something, get people real excited, and then I got very lucky with this gifted cast and with you know, some financiers, producers that backed me, supported me, and believed this dream was possible.
What was the first scene you shot?
It was inside the limousine when Richard is screaming into the telephone at his associate, you know.
Where's Mayfield?
Find out and get back to me! And I'll never forget it because it was Richard came, we'd been rehearsing for a month, but he came with such intensity into that moment. And he really, boom, he was on the set and that was that character, you know. And all the work that we had done paid off right there. I said, okay, we're going to be okay now.
I wish I had more time to ask you more questions, but I mean, they have been signaling for me to wind up the interview.
Da 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 da.
So, your Twitter handle says, filmmaker, computer geek, art worshipper, and business head. I'm just going to end up with the art worshipper. There's a photograph of yours in that art gallery in the film.
Milady. The photograph of mine is actually in the girlfriend's apartment. It's on the back wall.
Stand corrected.
You know, art was very important to me in this film. We had a tremendous art consultant, Linda Yablonsky, and you know, I would drive her and the production designer crazy to say, well, here's some paintings to look at. I say, okay, I'd like to see 500 paintings. And they bring me another 10 or 20 paintings. I go, oh, that's great, 480 to go. And they go, we thought you were joking. I said, no, I'm not joking. I want to see 500 paintings. So we went through this exhaustive search of art. And then in the end, we have these terrific artists, Victor Rodriguez, who made all the paintings in the gallery, whom I had seen and liked and said, I'll make you a free show. Mary Ellen Mark, you know, all these like masters, Ross Bleckner, lent art that is there, would be there, and I feel gave authenticity to this world. And we try to bring an emotional component to each piece in each place. So
would I be right in assuming that you follow your father's dictum, Jarecki's law of time management?
Well, the Jarecki's law has a explanation that says the work output increases with the square of the multiple. So that a person working 10 hours a day, a person working 8 hours a day, can do not twice as much as a person working 4 hours a day, but four times as much. So that is an absurd calculation that was just invented by him. I happen to know this because he's confessed it to me. However, the bottom line of it is the old Makata logo maxim, the crest, which says adhere and prosper. And it's all about hard work, you know. I've done things now that have so exceeded what I ever thought possible that I know that nothing is impossible. But it's also, you know, a pain to get there. You gotta be willing to dig the ditch. So if you're willing, you can do whatever you want.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.